my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help. Therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My God.
Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. One of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said,
"What are you willing to give me if I hand him over to you?"
They paid him 30 pences of silver. silver, and from that time on, he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples approached Jesus and said,
"Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?"
He said,
"Go into the city to a certain man and tell him the teacher says, 'My appointed time draws near. In your house I shall celebrate the Passover with my disciples.'"
The disciples then did as Jesus had ordered and prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he reclined at the table with the 12, and while they were eating, he said,
"Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me."
Deeply distressed at this, they began to say to him, one after another,
"Surely it is not I, Lord."
He said in reply,
"He who has dipped his hand into the dish with me is the one who will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born."
Then Judas, his betrayer, said in reply,
"Surely it is not I, Rabbi."
He answered,
"You have said so."
While they were eating, Jesus took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said,
"Take and eat. This is my body."
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying,
"Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed on behalf of many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, from now on, I shall not drink this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you, new in the kingdom of my Father."
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"This night all of you will have your faith in me shaken, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be dispersed. But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee.'"
Peter said to him in reply,
"Though all may have had their faith in you shaken, mine will never be."
Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times.
Peter said to him,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you."
And all the disciples spoke likewise. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I go over there and pray."
He took along Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee and began to feel sorrow and distress when he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch with me."
He advanced a little and fell prostrate in prayer, saying,
"My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will."
When he returned to his disciples, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
"So you could not keep watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Withdrawing a second time, he prayed again,
"My Father, if it is not possible that this cup pass without my drinking it, your will be done."
Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open. He left them and withdrew again and prayed a third time, saying the same thing again. When he returned to his disciples and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Behold, the hour is at hand when the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. Look, my betrayer is at hand."
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a large crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests and the elders of the people. His betrayer had arranged a sign with them, saying,
"The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him."
Immediately, when he went over to Jesus and said,
"Hail, Rabbi,"
and he kissed him, Jesus answered him,
"Friend, do what you have come for."
Then stepping forward, he laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. And behold, one of those who accompanied Jesus put his hand to his sword, drew it, and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him,
"Put your sword back into its sheath, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot call upon my Father, and he will not provide me at this moment with more than 12 legions of angels? But then how will the scriptures be fulfilled, which say that it must come to pass in this way?"
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
"Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I sat teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me. But all this has come to pass, that the writings of the prophets may be fulfilled."
Then all the disciples left him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus led him away to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled. Peter was following him at a distance as far as the high priest's courtyard, and going inside, he sat down with the servants to see the outcome. The chief priest and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain false testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward who stated,
"This man said, 'I can destroy the temple of God, and within 3 days rebuild it.'"
The high priest rose and addressed him,
"Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?"
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
"I order you to tell us under oath before the living God whether you are the Christ, the Son of God."
Jesus said to him in reply,
"You have said so, but I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his robes and said,
"He has blasphemed. What future need have we of witnesses? You have now heard the blasphemy. What is your opinion?"
Then they said in reply,
"He deserves to die."
Then they spat in his face and struck him, while some slapped him, saying,
"Prophesy for us, Christ. Who is it that struck you?"
Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. One of the maids came to him and said,
"You too were with Jesus the Galilean."
But he denied it in front of everyone, saying,
"I do not know what you are talking about."
As he went out to the gate, another girl saw him and said to those who were there,
"This man was with Jesus the Nazarene."
Again he denied it with an oath,
"I do not know that man."
A little later, the bystanders came over and said to Peter,
"Surely you too are one of them. Even your speech gives you away."
At that he began to curse and to swear,
"I do not know the man."
And immediately a cock crowed. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had spoken,
"Before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times.
He went out and began to weep bitterly. When it was morning, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that Jesus had been condemned, deeply regretted what he had done. He returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying,
I have sinned in betraying innocent blood.
They said,
what is that to us? Look to it yourself.
Flinging the money into the temple, he departed and went off and hanged himself. The chief priests gathered up the money, but said,
it is not lawful to deposit this in the temple treasury, for it is the price of blood.
After consultation, they used it to buy the potter's field as a burial place for the foreigners. That is why that field, even today, is called the field of blood. Then was fulfilled what had been said through Jeremiah the prophet. And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the value of a man with a price on his head, a price set by some of the Israelites, that they paid it out for the potter's field, just as the Lord had commanded them. Now Jesus stood before the governor, Pontius Pilate, and he questioned him,
are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus said,
you say so.
And when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he made no answer. Then Pilate said to him,
do you not hear how many times they are testifying against you?
But he did not answer him one word, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now on the occasion of the feast, the governor was accustomed to release to the crowd one prisoner whom they wished. And at that time they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had assembled, Pilate said to them,
which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus called Christ?
For he knew that it was out of envy that they had handed him over. While he was still seated on the bench, his wife sent him a message. Have nothing to do with that righteous man. I suffered much in a dream today because of him. The chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas, but to destroy Jesus. Then the governor said to them in reply,
which of the two do you want me to release to you?
They answered,
Barabbas.
Pilate said to them,
then what should I do with Jesus called Christ?
They all said,
let him be crucified.
But he said,
why? What evil has he done?
Then they only shouted the louder,
let him be crucified.
When Pilate saw that he was not succeeding at all, but that a riot was breaking out instead, he took water and washed his hands in the sight of the crowd, saying,
I am innocent of this man's blood. Look to it yourselves.
And the whole people said in reply,
his blood be upon us and upon our children.
Then he released Barabbas to them, but after he had Jesus scourged, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus inside the praetorium and gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped off his clothes and threw a scarlet military cloak about him. Weaving a crown out of thorns, they placed it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying,
hail, King of the Jews!
They spat upon him and took the reed and kept striking him on the head. And when they mocked him, they stripped him of the cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him off to crucify him. As they were going out, they met a Cyrenian named Simon. This man they pressed into service to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, they gave Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he had tasted it, he refused to drink. After they had crucified him, they divided his garments by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there. And they placed over his head a written charge against him. This is Jesus, the King of Jews. Two revolutionaries were crucified with him, one on his right and the other on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying,
"You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, and come down from the cross."
Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him and said,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. So he is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusted in God. Let him deliver him now if he wants him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'"
The revolutionaries who were crucified with him also kept abusing him in the same way. From noon onward, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani,"
which means,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard this said,
"This one is calling for Elijah."
Immediately, one of them ran to get a sponge. He soaked it in wine and, putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink. But the rest said,
"Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to save him."
But Jesus cried out again in a loud voice and gave up his spirit. And behold, the veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth quaked, rocks were split, tombs were opened, and the bodies of many saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming forth from their tombs after his resurrection, they entered the holy city and appeared to many. The centurion and the men with him who were keeping watch over Jesus feared greatly when they saw the earthquake and all that was happening, and they said,
"Truly, this was the Son of God."
There were many women there, looking on from a distance, who had followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering to him. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was himself a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Christ. Then Pilate ordered it to be handed over. Taking the body, Joseph wrapped it in clean linen and laid it in his new tomb that he had hewn in the rock. Then he rolled a huge stone across the entrance of the tomb and departed. But Mary Magdalene and the other Mary remained sitting there facing the tomb. The next day, the one following the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said,
"Sir, we remember that this impostor, while still alive, said, 'After 3 days, I will be raised up.' Give orders then that the grave be secured until the third day, lest his disciples come and steal him and say to the people, 'He has been raised from the dead.' This last imposture would be worse than the first."
Pilate said to them,
"The guard is yours. Go, secure it as best you can."
So they went and secured the tomb by fixing a seal to the stone and setting the guard.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My brothers and sisters, Normally, I don't preach on Palm Sunday once a year, because the gospel itself is a homily itself, and how can I improve upon that? However, we find ourselves in a unique, weird situation where churches, schools, and businesses are closed down for a couple of weeks to deal with this virus. Perhaps now is the time to have a much deeper discussion about the long gospel that we heard this morning. As we enter Holy Week, we are presented with a very rich tradition of Scripture that covers the entire period of salvation history. At the time that Christ entered Jerusalem, it has become obvious that he at least is a prophet sent by God. But this Lamb of God has now become the Lamb of sacrifice. So let us look at the five groups of people and how they reacted to this Son of God. First, we have the disciples, who are with Christ in good times, but they did not hang around long enough for the bad. They walked with Jesus to Jerusalem when he was king, proclaimed king of Israel. But as soon as his suffering began, they quickly went to sleep in the garden and then ran away after that. Second group, the Jewish leaders. They felt threatened by Christ because Christ has been faithful to God through and through. They did not like to be challenged about their own sinfulness, nor did they like the fact how people responded to Jesus Christ. They did not want to believe in the miracles, and they refused to believe the message of the miracles. They not only refused to believe those miracles, but they manufactured lies in order to kill him. Third group, Pontius Pilate. He lacked the gift of fortitude. He was more concerned what other people were thinking of him. The fact that an innocent man is going to be put to death. His position of governor was threatened by the Jews through rebellion. He clearly did not want to condemn Jesus, but he was not willing to pay the price to do the right thing. Fourth group is Judas. He betrayed Christ for money. He was not concerned for the poor, but only himself. He was a slave to money. And in the end, he loved money more than Christ. The fifth group, the crowd, was very fickle. One day they proclaimed Christ the King of Israel, and yet in a few days they said, "We have no king but Caesar." Are we as fickle as that when it comes to being a Christian? Are we faithful and steadfast, or do you go whatever the crowd does? Each of these five groups presents us a whole lot of information for personal reflection. We will reap what we are now sowing. If you sow in the flesh, you will reap a harvest of corruption. But if you sow in the Spirit, then we will reap the fruits of our death and resurrection into eternal life. The choice is ours. Hopefully we will choose wisely. Blood gives love. The blood and the cup of suffering are the centerpiece of God's saving and life-giving action. In the blood of Christ, which has flowed from his crucified body, we are now liberated from the ultimate consequences of our sins if we follow the way of Peter and not the way of Judas. God offers, we respond, and everything depends upon our response. It's important for us, my brothers and sisters, and the Lord's passion, suffering, and death, cannot be overstated. So how will we respond to him? Can we accept God's forgiveness to us? Judas did not. Peter at first could not, but later he did. The harsh truth is that Jesus Christ, God's own Son, was innocent and unjustly suffered rejection and pain. What about us? Do we enter the passion death of Christ, or are we too busy to care? God offers. So what is our choice? The gospel readings present to us two contradictory aspects of our own lives. We all have moments of triumph, victory, joy, and moments of pain, sorrows, and suffering. We are happy and elated when we become successful, when jobs are secure, we're in good health, and people appreciate us. However, at times we also feel very low, isolated and unhappy when we are betrayed by people we love, insulted, and even neglected. In the gospel passage, we are greatly encouraged to know that God, who came to be among us in the person of Jesus Christ, bore all the suffering, evil, which we human beings encounter, that even Christ himself felt sad and abandoned. At the very same time, we take comfort in knowing that the same Lord is standing by us and will strengthen us when we feel abandoned and feel left out. Perhaps this Passion Sunday, this Holy Week, will have much more deeper meaning, unlike the last 50 years, because we're currently experiencing the world right now. Perhaps our stress, our anxiety, and doubts and fears we have now, that can be part of our prayer this week in the Easter Vigil. Perhaps the Passion Sunday today, we can truly identify the suffering of Christ himself. My brothers and sisters, as we go through this day, reflect on this Holy Week, let us look carefully at Jesus, our Savior. We watch not just to admire, but also to learn, to pierce the mind, the attitudes, and the values of Jesus, so that we, in very similar circumstances ourselves, at times, may walk his own footsteps as well. Today and this week, my brothers and sisters, our church takes us to the core of God's forgiving and self-emptying love for us. If we are his disciples, he invites us to walk in his way, to share in his sufferings, to imitate his attitudes, to empty ourselves, and to live in service of one another. In other words, we need to love as Jesus loves. This is not a call to a life of pain and misery. Of course not. Quite the contrary. It is an invitation to a life of deep freedom, peace, and happiness. So, will we follow Jesus in good times and in bad, sickness and in health, all the days of our lives? God bless you all.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men, for our salvation. he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come. Amen. So let us turn to our Lord and lift up our prayers to our God.
For the domestic church, that all families fully unite themselves this holy week to our Lord in his great work of mercy, we pray to you, Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the human family, that all politic, economic, and medical leaders of the nations work together to end this pandemic and protect the lives of their people, we
Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that, though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty, our salvation, always, everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty, his death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration, we acclaim. They may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed, and willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of a new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Gustavo, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep to hope the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them to the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, your spouse, the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages. May we merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as you wait the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ, for the kingdom, power, and glory, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your
spirit. Let us offer each other the sign. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things. I desire to receive you into my soul, since that I cannot come at this moment to receive you sacramentally. Come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be
by going online or mail it to the office, or come by the office and place it through the front door mail spot anytime. The church doors now are only open on Sundays for private prayer in the afternoon and for confessions on Saturday at 4:30 p.m. and Monday at 6:30 p.m. Come join us on our Facebook or our parish YouTube channel. See daily Mass, a Holy Week retreat with Tim Gonzalez, Stations of the Cross, and more. Happy Holy Week! Join us live stream on Facebook with special events. On Wednesdays at 7 p.m., we will have a family cedar meal. Holy Thursday Mass will be televised at 7 p.m., followed by adoration until midnight. Good Friday is a holy day of prayer and fasting. Please join us at 2 p.m. for the Divine Mercy Chaplet and seven last words. At 3 p.m., we will be the Living Stations of the Cross. At 7 p.m., will be the Veneration of the Cross service. Our Easter Vigil will be Saturday at 8:30 p.m., and our Easter Sunday Masses at 9 and 10:45 a.m. Those preparing for sacraments for baptism, communion, confirmation, and marriage, keep preparing. Many of you, God willing, with 10 people or less, will be receiving your sacraments this coming Easter season. Thank you and God bless you.
Thank you, Sonia. Sonia is our be afraid. Fear is useless. All that is needed is trust. So again, thank you. Sonia is the president of the Pastoral Council. This past Friday, we had about 29 or so heads of ministries gathering together on Facebook. We're having to use creative ways in this time to stay together. The church building might be closed, but the church is open and alive because Jesus is alive. Amen. So we want to bless now your call. So hopefully you got the message, so you have some nice, some greenery with you. We're going to bless your palms. If you have any candles or any other religious article through the Facebook, we want to bless them at this time. And the invitation is to place it in front of your door and take a picture of your house that's covered with the precious blood of the Lamb, Hosanna in the highest. So if you can hold up your palms, let us pray. Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, come. And we have more poems in the refrigerator, so don't come to church because, no, we can't give out poems at this time. But God willing, when we all can return, they'll be waiting for us in the refrigerator. Let us pray. May reach eternal Jerusalem through him, who lives and reigns forever and ever.